All right, welcome back in. 5:15 from the Princeton Orthopedic Associates Studios. Warriors win game two. LeBron gets a triple-double, but not enough. And he did everything that he could last night. Just wasn't getting the help as the Warriors cruise to a 19-point victory. And this thing will go to Cleveland as the Warriors are up 2-0. And now joining us on the hotline right now, a 1975 Finals MVP. Scored over 25,000 points in his illustrious Hall of Fame career. That, of course, is the great Rick Barry. He's kind enough to hop on board with us right now. Rick, appreciate a few minutes. Thanks for the time, and how are you?
I'm doing great, thanks. If I was any better, I'd be making a comeback in the NBA.
Well, now you're fishing these days from the last time we were talking. How's the fishing season been?
Well, I haven't had a chance to do very much. I'm scheduled to go on one at the end of this month, though, up to Alaska, which should be fun, although it will be cut a little short because I'm coaching in the Big Three, Ice Cube's new three-on-three league. That should be a lot of fun. So I'll be in Brooklyn and in the first weekend event that we're going to have for the summer. So the only bad part about it is it cuts my fishing trip back by a couple of days.
That's awesome. Who's your squad for this three-on-three tournament coming up?
Well, here's the thing. Is that they gave the name to my team the Ball Hogs, which I'm not exactly thrilled about. We just have to make sure we don't play like Ball Hogs. But the bottom line of it is that we're going to be real underdogs. I'm going to give you a big name. I mean, the biggest name we have is Brian Scalabrine. He's
really?
The captain of the team. And Josh Childs is the co-captain. Some of these other guys got, Gary Payton's coaching, of course, but then you got Allen Iverson, and you got some other guys that, were all-star players who are going to be playing. So we will definitely be the underdogs, and it'll be fun. It's going to be fun to see what actually happens here. I almost missed my turn. I'm driving, so excuse me for that. It's going to be fun. I'm looking forward to it, and just looking forward to Wednesday night to see if the Warriors could take care of business like they have. I mean, it was pretty impressive what they were able to do against Cleveland when Cleveland had their three best players have good games in two of the games. And of course, in the triple-double, almost had one in the first game as well. So I said after the first game, I said that, wow, it's unbelievable that Tyronn Lue has got to be saying, okay, what can I do to win? So, okay, LeBron, you got to go and score more points. You got to get more. He got to get more, and he did go get more, and all three of them, did well, and they got crushed, and the Warriors turned the ball over 20 times on top of that. So that's a scary situation that you're looking at here.
You couldn't play better last night if you were LeBron, but you just can't do anything when Durant goes for 33, 13, 6, 5, and 3. Steph Curry gets a triple-double. Klay Thompson gives you 22 and 7. And then Draymond gets 5 fouls, but he still gives you 12 points and 6 rebounds. So you asked the question. Now let's see if you could answer it. What can Cleveland do if they want to win one of these games? Because I just don't see it.
Pray. I always said this, before you play the Warriors, you kind of have to pray and hope that two of their three guys between Klay, Steph, and KD, that two of those guys are not going to be shooting the ball well. I mean, obviously Klay was struggling for a while, and I was happy to see him come out of it. I spoke to him. I found out that Jerry West had talked to him too, just to get his confidence up, tell him a few things that we thought he could do, and glad to see him break out of it. But yeah, but even with only two of the guys doing it, the last five, six games, those two guys have combined from between almost high 40s up to 60 something points together, KD and Steph. And so when that happens, your chances of beating that team are so minimized. And then now you get all three of them going. You saw what happened, even with the sloppy play and turning the ball over after they only turned it over four times in the previous game, they still won by almost 20. So, I mean, Cleveland's they just have to get other people play well. If the other people don't play well, I mean, LeBron, you can't expect LeBron, and you just can't expect those guys, to him and Kyrie and Love, to have to carry the entire burden. They got some issues. And first of all, they got to find a way to play better defense. I mean, right now, they have no way of stopping the Warriors. You're giving up 60-plus points, right? 60-plus points in half. I mean, and then they're scoring 120 points in the game. How do you expect to win games when you're playing that kind of defense?
You just can't, and that's why they're in this 2-0 hole right now. I don't see how they come up with a game plan to try to stop this attack of the Warriors as Rick Barry joins us right now. Is this Warriors team, because you've seen almost every team that's been in the league, you've been around for a long time, is this Warriors team the best team you've ever seen?
No, it's not the best team, but it's certainly one of the best teams that I've ever seen. The difference being is, you know, nowadays you don't really have super quality centers. I mean, when you start talking about, you know, some of the teams that I've seen, that you've got Bill Russell, and you've got Wilt Chamberlain and Nate Thurmond and some of these other great players, Kareem. It's a different game today. I was talking with Larry Harris, you know, Del Harris' son is a scout for the Warriors. And we were saying, I mean, this is amazing that you look out and you watch games now and there's no centers on the court. They don't even play with centers a lot of the time. So, and it's a whole different world that exists. An entirely different world that exists today in the NBA. Now, do the Warriors have an outstanding team? Yes, they do. I mean, come on. There are four players with Draymond included among the big three in the offensive. I mean, that's maybe as potent a team as, you know, has ever been out there. When you talk about four guys who can really, you know, do something to help your team win. But as far as going down on the bench, the depth of the bench, I mean, come on, some of these other teams back in those days, I mean, come on, when I first came in the league, there was only like 9 or 10 people. And I mean, and they were all good people who could have been starters on other teams. And some, like, I just look at one thing. There's some guys playing today who made an insane amount of money playing today, $40-something million contracts. They couldn't have made that player to guard. He could not have played and made. He couldn't have made our roster with the Warriors in 75. Couldn't have made it. Couldn't have.
The 96 Bulls. Crazy. How would the 96 Bulls fare against these Warriors this year?
That would be, you know, it'd be interesting to watch them play. They had some outstanding players as well. I mean, you had one of the greatest players of all time, the best two guard in Michael Jordan. You know, now you've got someone. I mean, come on, you've got. KD is like an amazing player. I mean, not only will he maybe get his first title this year, if he keeps playing the way he's playing, he's going to be the MVP of the championship series. So might not be a too bad a move that he made. And then we've got Steph, who plays the point guard position like no other point guard's ever played the game. Incredible. Three guys who are not only scorers, but they're shooters. Okay, shooters, scorers, who can make their free throws, get to the basket. Come on, how many teams can defend that? They can't. That's why the Warriors are winning so many games, because they play unselfishly. They move the ball. When they're playing that kind of basketball offensively, and they're also focusing and playing some good defense, they're a very difficult team to beat. You just have to hope that they're having some off nights and catch them on a downtime when you're playing some of your best basketball in order to be able to beat them. They're a heck of a basketball team. Even without, just think what would happen if they had a great center. Oh, my God. It'd be crazy, you know. JaVale's doing a nice job coming off the bench and giving him some energy, but they have nothing of any great significance in the center position. You give that team an outstanding center who can block shots and rebound and score a few points for you. Now you're talking about a team that could be one of the greatest teams ever in the history of the game.
Rick Barry with us right now, wrapping up with the legend in the NBA, of course, over 25,000 points in his Hall of Fame career. Rick, you look at LeBron James, and like we've been talking about, it's unbelievable the amount of hate that this guy gets, and he just continues to put up just tremendous performance after tremendous performance, but they just can't do anything right now as this Warriors team is unguardable. What do you say about the people that still show some hate to LeBron, especially in this series?
Yeah, I don't understand that. I mean, to me, he's the greatest three to play the game. Everybody keeps talking about the greatest player. I mean, any team sport, you have to pick players by positions. It takes different talent to play different positions. And LeBron is very versatile, can do a lot of different things. But he's a great, great basketball player. Does he have some shortcomings? Yeah, he does. He has some flaws in his game. I made a big deal years ago about his shooting. He improved that quite a bit. But he's still never been to where he needs to be. He's never been 80% free throw shooter. He's not a great shooter, but he does so many other things so incredibly well. And I think what happens in life is that when somebody is as great as he is, people have a tendency to think about, you know, wanting to, you know, just cause a real problem for these kind of guys as far as knocking them off their pedestal. You know, I mean, it's like jealousy in a way. And it's really sad, because LeBron's, you know, a good guy, does a lot of really good things in the community and helps a lot of other people out. He's just a heck of a basketball player. And again, there's never been somebody like him. I call guys anomalies that play the position differently and they're built differently than anybody else has ever before playing that position. That's LeBron at the three. You got Steph at the point guard. You have also now Kevin Durant. There's never been a guy 7 feet tall doing the things that this guy can do. So he's another anomaly. Charles Barkley was an anomaly. Shaq because of his power and strength. So you can go down the list. But there's not like, just tons and tons of these guys that fall into that category that are so unique because of the way that they play the game at such a high level.
There's been a lot of conversation about how you keep this Warriors team together, and that conversation has even come here to Philadelphia because a lot of people have this idea of eventually getting Klay Thompson on the Sixers. Klay's going to be an unrestricted free agent in 2019. What do you think the future beholds for this Warriors team, specifically with Klay Thompson?
Well, here's the thing, is that, they make so much money now. Is it all about your ego because you want to be a star and score points, or is it that the fact that you want to have a chance to be on one of the great teams in the history of the game and have a chance to win championships all the time? Why would you not want to be a part of that as opposed to worrying about your own individual accomplishments? You're a part of the team. You're an integral part of the team's success. Why not enjoy that? I really do think that somewhere down the road that Shaq and Kobe are going to be sitting around sometime and saying to themselves, what the heck were we thinking? Because they had a chance to be one of the greatest teams ever, amass a huge number of championships if they had stayed together, and they didn't do that. I mean, come on, how much money do you have to have? Nowadays, they make so much money, it's not about money anymore. So put your ego aside. Be a part of something incredibly special.
Do you think this Warriors team will put their egos aside?
I would hope so. I think that they will. I think they're enjoying themselves. I love the way that they play, and it's going to be interesting to see how it plays out. I don't know. It's a matter of, again, they make so much money now. How much more money can you spend? But, yeah, obviously, if you're not a max player and some team's willing to offer you a max contract and you know you can be there and kind of be more of the guy, is that more important than making a few less than making some less millions, not dollars, millions of dollars? And to be on a team that can't win. I mean, how enjoyable is that to be on a team that loses as opposed to a team that wins and still make a lot of money? And that's just the way I'm thinking and looking at it. I mean, like sometimes I joked about it. I remember when the Phoenix Suns were doing stuff and Amari Stoudemire and then Sean Marion left. I mean, I said, hell, see, I would give up part of my salary to be able to stay and play with Steve Nash. And neither one of those guys ever did as much as they did when they played with Nash, because he just made things so easy for them and made it so much more fun, and they were a better team. And that's the type of thing that, I can't answer that for Klay Thompson and know what's going through his head. I hope he stays, because I'd love to see the Warriors continue to be a dominant team. If they all stay together, they've got a chance to win a bunch of championships over the next 5-6 years.
Now, Rick, before we let you run, let's just get in a little more Sixers conversation, because I know you're a big fan of Ben Simmons, even though he did not play this year. Sixers also have Joel Embiid. It wasn't that long ago that the Warriors were just hitting gold in the draft, getting Steph Clay, and then also picking up Draymond in the second round. The current state of the Sixers, how do you evaluate the growth of that franchise?
Well, to be honest with you, I don't look all that closely at them, because that's not the team that I necessarily follow, but certainly they have some nice young players. And it all comes down to three things when you have a team sport to be successful. Who do you draft? Who do you get in free agency? Who do you trade for? And then you hope you have a coach that doesn't screw it up. If you don't have the players, you can't win. Now, it's not necessarily just getting players who have great individual talent. You got to get players who know how to play the game, who have talent, who have character, who are more concerned about doing what they can to help their team become a champion than it is about their own individual egos and what they can accomplish individually. And so it's really something important to be able to analyze your personnel, very, very fine-tune that so that you can get those right people, and then you've got a chance to do it. And so with those guys that you just mentioned and talked about, certainly they're going down the right path, but now you have to add the other elements to it.
With the draft coming up, a lot has been made about LaVar Ball and his son, Lonzo Ball. And I'll ask you this question because you had a few sons play professionally with basketball. What advice would you give to LaVar Ball, the way that he's putting his kid in a tough spot right now with the loquacious personality?
Even the fact that this is being brought up is really ridiculous. I mean, this man, and I even said something to USA, was that my only thing is he's doing his children a disservice by what he's doing and the way he's conducting himself. It's a shame that his kids have to answer questions about their father and all the craziness that he's doing. I would say let the kids play, determine what's going to happen, and let the publicity come from that. Let that speak for him, not his father out there saying all these outrageous things that he's doing. And the fact that he's getting all this publicity and going on guests on TV shows and everything, all this is doing to add more fuel to the fire for a ludicrous situation that is kind of appalling to me, to be perfectly honest. I mean, to be talking the way he is. Hey, I have no problem saying, hey, my son's a nice player. I'll say that. My son Canyon is a hidden gem. My son Canyon can play. But I'm not going to say my son Canyon is better than Steph Curry or better than this and doing that. I don't even know what's happening with that crazy shot that, you know, he's got, whether or not he's going to be a great NBA player or not. That's still to be determined. I mean, yeah, so let's just see what the heck happens and let the kids play, determine as to how good he is and what he can make of himself. So, you know, I'm more concerned about my son getting an opportunity to play because nobody's seen what he can do. I mean, heck, if my son had been at the Chicago Combine where he got tested at Portsmouth and some other places, he would have been first in three of the categories, second in one, and third in the other. He would have had the highest vertical of anybody in Chicago. People don't even realize what an athlete my son is.
Before we let you run, Rick, last one. We appreciate you giving us a few minutes today as we're talking to Rick Barry right now. I have to ask you a little bit something about the way that you shot your free throws. And, of course, we see people struggling at their free throws. That's always going to be a problem with certain big men. And you look at Wilt Chamberlain, and he went through that time where he would vacillate from shooting it the way that you did and then also going back to the traditional way. And even Wilt said before that he felt like a little bit of a sissy doing it underhand. Just give me a little bit about Wilt shooting the underhand free throws, and then also why you think some players still won't take that risk of doing it the way that you did it.
I have no idea why they have an aversion to it. I didn't want to do it because girls shot that way. They don't do that now. So what difference does it make how you shoot them as long as they're going in? And it's a matter of trying to get free points. They're called free throws. And to not be able to make four out of every five you shoot and shoot 80% of the free throw net, I think is ludicrous that you can't do that. I mean, that's crazy. Especially getting paid multi-millions of dollars and you can't perfect shooting the free throw the same distance, the same ball size, the same basket size every single time you do it with nobody guarding you. I mean, it's almost embarrassing, to be honest with you. And here's the irony of it. I did the podcast with Malcolm Gladwell talking about Wilt. I mean, Wilt, actually, the year he scored 50 points a game and when he scored 100 and was 28 for 32, he made from the free throw line shooting underhand. And why in the world, when you just had the best year you've ever had, and you're shooting underhand, would you switch? I mean, what sense did that make? So I don't understand what the problem is with guys. I would think you would try anything at all to get to be better at shooting free throws. So, and listen, if they can't do that and they don't want to go to mine, that's fine. My son Canyon, I mean, he almost shot 90% this year shooting underhand. But get my son. My son Scooter's got a thing called Solid Shot. It's the greatest teaching tool. It was sophisticated sensor technology. He had Andre Drummond. DeAndre Jordan, in three short sessions working with this, he changed the shot, had him shooting over 70% for the free throw line.
Wow.
Over 70% for the free throw line, and he stopped working on it. He didn't keep working on it, and the team didn't bring him in to keep my son working with him. Over 70% in three short sessions using the shooting sleeve.
But
unbelievable.
Tell me a little bit, because those numbers are alarming and they're unbelievable. Tell me a little bit more about that shooting sleeve.
Well, it's incredible. It's not difficult. I'm trying to help them raise the money so we can get the cost down so somebody can, you know, purchase it and get kids to do it. I'm trying to see if we can get, you know, somehow to get Under Armour or somebody to do it. It would be the perfect thing if Steph Curry got behind it. Kids could actually go and buy the sleeve if Steph was behind it and Under Armour did it. You could program in all the parameters as to what Steph does when he shoots. And you could buy the sleeve, and a kid could buy that sleeve, put it on, and he could learn every time he shoots, getting instant feedback to get himself programmed to be able to have the exact same shooting form as Steph Curry.
Well, Rick, hey, we appreciate the time today. Always fun to talk to you. Enjoy the fishing trip coming up and also the basketball league that you're getting into. We appreciate it, Rick.
Thanks. Take care. God bless you and your listeners.